Good morning. Welcome to Memorial Lutheran Church. We're glad that you could join us this morning from home as we come to worship and we come together in worship. We're glad you're here. And we pray that in this time that you are able to come and worship and be present and listen to the word and share in this time. And this morning we are looking at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, and that's Jesus on the road to Emmaus. And when we're looking at the presence of God in our lives, we look at what these men on this road to Emmaus felt. And we can imagine that for the disciples, this must have been, after Jesus' death and resurrection, a time of doubt when his presence felt to not be there. Maybe you feel the same way. In this time, maybe you feel just as lonely as those men on that road that day felt, wondering if God's presence is absent from our lives. We are reminded that the Lord's promise is real, the Lord is present, and God delivers on his promise. And as we begin worship, we begin with song.
Who wore a sin and shame, now robed in was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the
begin this morning by calling on the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Lord God, as we gather before you today, we acknowledge that you are holy and all-powerful, and that we are flawed and imperfect people. I confess my sinfulness to you. My own human nature is sinful to begin with. I've sinned by doing things you've called me not to do. I've sinned by not doing things that you want me to do. My words, my thoughts, and my actions so often fail to communicate your love to those around me. Confess with me. Forgive me, Heavenly Father, through your Son, Jesus, our risen Lord, Jesus Christ, who gave everything for me. In his name I pray. Amen. Our Almighty God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, promises his gracious presence to you. Yes, it is through Jesus that we are made right with God. Your sins are forgiven. And so you have nothing to fear from his presence. He is with you to bless you and to keep you. Amen.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. the stone away.
We pray. Bless us, Lord, with the promise of your gracious presence with us through all things. Encourage us now with your presence in your words of life and promise, which we hear in Scripture this morning. Through Jesus, our Savior. Amen. And so our first reading this morning comes from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 17 through 25. Since you call on the Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorifies him. And so your faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. For all people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Our gospel reading this morning comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Now, that same day, two of them, Jesus' followers, were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, for they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they walked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the one visiting Jerusalem? Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem that does not know of the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all people. The chief priests and all rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amaze us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they did not find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, "How foolish are you, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken? Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all Scripture concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the Scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he had broke bread. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's time for Kids Time. I'm Liz. And I don't know if you guys know this, but I wear glasses. I wear contacts when I don't have my glasses on. Here are my glasses. But, you know, I was thinking about when I took these off this morning, how dirty they were. And sometimes when your glasses are so dirty, it is tough to see anything. And so you need to use a glass cleaner and a special little cloth so you don't scratch the glasses. And you get them all clean and then they're clear. And then when you put them on, you can see clearly. And that's pretty amazing. And sometimes it really is amazing. And I don't realize how dirty they were. My son Charlie always has dirty, yucky glasses. And I have to tell him, give them to me because I can't stand seeing them so dirty. So we want to see clearly. And today, if you were just listening to Pastor Doug, he read about the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Now, I think that Jesus was being really sneaky because it says they were kept from recognizing him. And so he starts asking them questions. And he asks them what happened. And they tell him about this guy, Jesus, who died on the cross. And when they went to the tomb, his body wasn't there. They didn't know who they were talking with. They were with Jesus. Oh, and then finally their eyes were opened and they could see and they were like, "Oh, were our hearts not burning within us?" They saw. Jesus wants us to see him. And so here's my other pair of glasses that I can wear today, my cross glasses. He wants us to be cross-eyed. We want to see Jesus in everything that we do, to keep our eyes on him, to know that he loves us, to know that he saved us, to know that he forgives us, and that we are his, and that he is always with us, no matter what. He loves us. So let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear Father, we are thankful that as we travel this life, Jesus is always walking with us, and he will help us see the good and the bad in our lives. We love you, Jesus. Amen. All right, have a great day.
God's grace and his mercy and peace be yours in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Presence, being present in people's lives, having God's presence in our lives. Got a question I want to have you ask. And by the way, you that are in high school, you're experiencing something that none of us probably ever experienced, at least very few of us, the being apart from your friends at this very critical time of your high school education, especially you seniors. My heart goes out to you. But I also enjoy seeing the creativity that you're displaying as you communicate with one another. But the question that I've got that I want you to think about as well is a question that's often used when small groups gather together when you want to think about who you'd like to spend some time with. The question is this: if you could have dinner with one person in the world, living or having died already, dinner with one person in the world, who would that person be? Now, you can think about that just a little bit. In fact, if you really want, you can pause for a second if you want to talk about it in your group. Do you know who I often picked? It might sound kind of crazy, but I used to say I'd like to have dinner with President Richard Nixon. Yeah, he was president when I was becoming a teenager, that age when I was starting to become just aware of political things going on, and he was a very, very big figure, very controversial figure. And I always wondered what it would have been like for him to be in that kind of position very publicly and what his private life was like. I don't know if he would have opened up to me at a dinner, but I always thought I wanted to have dinner with President Richard Nixon. Now, I always also had to qualify this question by saying, no, you can't pick Jesus, because everybody says, oh, I want to have dinner with Jesus. No, that wasn't allowed in the question. The truth is, though, probably many of us would say, I'd love to have dinner with Jesus. That's kind of the situation the disciples were in, Cleopas and his companion, as they were walking on that road to Emmaus. They were beginning to miss Jesus already. He had been with them. He had been leading them. He was their teacher, their mentor. And he had died. And a gruesome death. And they were hurting. In fact, when the risen Lord Jesus came upon them and walked with them and they didn't recognize who he was, they were talking about all the events that had gone on in Jerusalem just those past few days and events that had traumatized them. They said, haven't you heard? Are you the only one that doesn't know what has gone on? Jesus of Nazareth. That's right, he died. And Jesus, in essence, says, well, tell me more. So they begin to talk and they begin to describe to him what had happened. And then Jesus enters the conversation. I'm going to come back to that again later. And it does wind up in a dinner together. They wanted to be in the presence of Jesus. They felt alone. They felt lonely. I was visiting with one of our memorial family this week and talking about that sense of separation that can come, especially if somebody contracts the virus. Monty Dell in our congregation has contracted the virus, and his family just asked to continue to pray for him, and that's why I'm using his name publicly. He's at Good Samaritan Village and contracted the virus, and we keep him in prayer. And we lift him up before the Lord. As I was having the conversation with this person from our congregation who works in the medical field, she said, we talked about this in our family as we began to kind of go along this road. What if one of us would get the virus? And she went on to say, she said, you know, I'm not afraid to die. I know this becomes a pretty heavy topic, but it's in our minds, is it not? She said, I'm not afraid to die. It's not that. It's that sense of being alone, not having my family around me. That's what can kind of hurt. That's what can kind of make me wonder. That's what can give me some anxiety. I understand that. It's not my intention to burden you with my story, but I do feel it might be appropriate for me to just share a little bit from my heart here. 25 years ago already, just about 25 years, we experienced a loss in our family. Our youngest son, Alan, we lived in Florida. We had a swimming pool in our home, and Alan made his way into our swimming pool when we did not see what was going on. We usually had a fence put up. We didn't this time. We didn't get it put up from the night before when we had friends over. We were busy. I was all around the house. Lisa was working in the kitchen, and we didn't see what happened. He got in our swimming pool, and I'm going to make the story shorter. Alan was in the hospital for a while. Alan died from drowning. And what's really hard about that sometimes, and please, I remind you, we've been 25 years of experience in our lives. We've experienced joys. We've experienced ups and downs like all of you do. And we've been so blessed by God and His presence with us always. But I know especially soon after His death, and what I can still struggle with sometimes is that sense of we left Alan alone, not knowing exactly what his experience was like. And it's almost kind of painful to try to imagine that too much, and you maybe experience that too, and please, thanks for listening. But that sense of leaving somebody alone, the sense of being alone, it's difficult. It's tough. And I believe that these days bring a heightened concern for us in feeling alone. But I have words to share with you that we begin to see taking shape in our gospel lesson. Those disciples walking to the road to Emmaus and feeling alone, feeling like they had been left out on something that was really important in life. This Jesus who was so promising, and then he dies on the cross, and they feel cut off from him. But as they begin to talk with Jesus, and Jesus begins to talk with them, Jesus begins to explain from the Scriptures that this had to happen, that Jesus would die. There would be this separation, that separation of death that we all experience. It was part of life experience when sin entered the world, when things were not so perfect anymore, when our lives became separated from God in that sense of perfection and oneness always in will, death would be there. But then Jesus went on to explain that not only would he die, but that he would rise again from the dead. And he would be present again. And the disciples, Cleopas and his companion, were talking with one another, and I think they kind of looked at each other a few times and raised their eyebrows, and Jesus began to explain more, and they were talking and talking. All of a sudden, they got to the location, and Jesus was going to go on, and they said, no, why don't you stay with us for a while? And so Jesus came into their home, and he had dinner with them. And as he broke the bread, God saw to it that the disciples understood who Jesus really was. They recognized him. They knew who he was. And then Jesus left them. But not to be gone forever and ever. But they now knew the promises of God that promised the presence of Jesus Christ for their lives for always. And they ran back to where the other disciples were, and they talked to them, and they said, it's true. And they all talked together and said, Peter saw him also. We're seeing Jesus. He's alive. The promise of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, of the Messiah, had come true. And we are not left alone. Jesus was raised from the dead. And Jesus later ascended into heaven. And again, that temptation to feel, well, Jesus is gone. He's not with us. We want him with us. Oh, but Jesus spoke to his disciples about the promise of his presence. And I, mind you, this is not just a thought or a wish. I wish somebody could be around again. I wish I could feel somebody by me. Or a feeling. This is a promise. A promise from God. I'd like you to listen to the words from Philippians chapter 3 that are tied to Easter and the resurrection. Philippians chapter 3, where Paul talks about wanting to be with Christ and wanting to know Christ, wanting that relationship with the risen Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 10 of chapter 3, he says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship, get that word, the coming together, the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. And he goes on in verse 20. He says, our citizenship is in heaven. He reminds us that our idea of presence is not just tied to this world and somebody who stands by me in this life right here. I can be left alone in this life. I can be left alone in this world. I could be left alone in a hospital room. I could be left alone feeling cut off from my friends. I could be left alone feeling cut off by my guilt, by my sin. But Paul reminds us of our full citizenship. And he says, our citizenship is in heaven. And from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, the one who bridges that gap and declares us His family, declares us in fellowship with the Father again, who's with us, who will transform our lowly body to be like His glorious body by the power that enables Him to subject all things to Himself. The power of God to be present. The power of God to promise our presence with Him in the resurrection. But it's not just heaven's presence. Jesus also, in talking with his disciples before he died, in fact, the night before he died, spoke to them about the Holy Spirit. God himself, God the Holy Spirit, who he promised would be with his disciples, present with them. He said, I will ask the Father and he will give you another counselor. By the way, the word counselor means somebody who comes right alongside to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. You know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. This is from John chapter 14, and now I read verse 20. Because I live, you also will live, and on that day you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Our God is present. Our God is present by his promise. Again, not just a feeling, not just a wish, not just a comforting maybe. The promise of God that came fully true at the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The promise of God that continues its promise to be with you in the presence of his word. The words that are proclaimed to us, the words we read in Scripture, is Jesus present with us, even when we're cut off and alone from everything else. The presence of our Lord Jesus Christ in his supper, we've been missing that presence, haven't we? How precious it is to be with the Lord Jesus Christ as he gives us his body and blood and holy communion. He is really with us, not just a wish, not just a memory. He is with us. Look forward to celebrating that gift again. But we have the promise of God to be with us always. And I encourage you with that promise. I encourage you. It's, I guess, like having dinner with Jesus, being with Him, being assured by Him, being alive in Him, looking forward to our heavenly presence with Him, looking forward to living all our days with Him, even as we live in this world. We live in the promises of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now we confess our faith in the Creator, the Redeemer, and Sustainer of all life through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now as we come to that time of offering, we are reminded that our lives are an offering of God's goodness. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 says, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things and in all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work." And so while God's presence is with us and around us, as Christ followers, we are called into His work and to share His presence with those who don't know Him. So I pray that in this moment that you can reflect and pray and see how God is using your life to work in His kingdom. And so now let's pray for the church as we pray as a family together for those in our community and around and those in our family. Let's pray. In You alone, O Lord, we live and move and have our being. Your Holy Spirit breathes life into us, moment by moment and day by day. Therefore, we are reminded of Your loving kindness. We are reminded of Your presence in all of creation and in all of our lives. God, we give thanks for the many blessings that we see each day. Lord, we give thanks for Dale and Robin as they celebrate 30 years of marriage. We give thanksgiving for the blessing of the birth of Bradley, the son of Brett and Teresa, on April 17th. Lord, we give thanks for the blessings and care for those directly and indirectly affected by this virus, for those that have gone through it and who are now healed. And Lord, we also give thanks for the students and the teachers and the parents who now have become teachers as You lift them up and give them the strength to make it through the end of this school year to continue this. We still do pray for the school districts. Well, we pray this week for Brandon Valley Middle School and Brandon Valley High School. And that even though they are not in the building, Lord, we know that their work is still necessary. And now they have an opportunity to connect right in the home of the families and the children that they serve. Lord, we also pray for those who are struggling with health concerns, those that are dealing with illness. We specifically lift up this week Holly, Brandon, Melissa, Amber, Mickey, Chris, John, Erica, Mike, Mark, Doug, Josh, Chris, Marvin, Sarah, Janet, Marilyn, Ann, Georgia, Matt, Lisa, Doug, Steve, Dorothy, and Evie. Lord, we pray that you bring comfort and healing as they walk this path, knowing that your presence is with them, feeling your comfort and your peace and your healing. We continue to pray for those that are dealing with ongoing illness and separation from others. We pray for Cheryl, for Jean, for Phil, and for Monty. And Lord, we pray for our country. We pray that as we navigate this challenge, this time, that you draw us closer together, that you show us what is important, and that we learn from this experience, and that our leaders can learn from this and continue to guide us with your direction. Lord, we pray that you open our hearts to your presence, asking that you be with us now and hold us in your strengthening care. Help us to put away all the distractions of our daily lives, to quiet our hearts and our minds, to seek and to know your presence with us now. And then teach us to wait peacefully in your presence and to cast all our cares onto you because you care for us. Give us, Almighty Creator, the gift of life renewed. Grant us, healing Savior, the gift of life renewed. Fill us, indwelling Spirit, with the gift of the precious life that you give, renewed. In you we pray. Amen. And now we pray the prayer that he has taught us. Pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who would trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, may you be the glory. The maker of heaven and of earth, but no one can comprehend your worth. The king over all the universe, may you be the glory. Raise me. in freedom all my days, now that I'm alive. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. And it's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and raises dead man's life. It's all because of Jesus. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and raised this dead man's life. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We are glad you were able to be part of this. And we pray blessings on your week as you continue to be the face and hands and body of Christ to a world that may not know him. Let me send you with a blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Have a blessed week.